Kunusakut. Good afternoon and welcome. My name is Victoria Dickinson. I'm the executive director here at the McMichael, and it's a huge privilege for me to welcome you here today to celebrate the remarkable legacy of Kenojuak Ashevak. Since its founding by Robert and Signe McMichael, the McMichael has actively collected the works of Aboriginal artists. Kenojuak has been to the McMichael several times, and in 1986, we were privileged to host her first retrospective. We also hosted her 80th birthday party. Today, we're celebrating her life and her work. I'm very pleased to welcome to the McMichael today three people who have known Kenojuak and will share their memories with us: Pat Feheley, Sarah Milroy, and Terry Ryan. But we're also joined, and it's a wonderful thanks to FaceTime, with Kenojuak's family and friends from Cape Dorset, including Bill Ritchie and the Mannings, who are here with us, if not in body, certainly in spirit, and we can wave to them in various ways. So it's my pleasure now to welcome first to the microphone Pat Feheley, a longtime friend of Kenojuak, to begin our conversation. Pat.
Thank you, Victoria. On January the 8th, 2013, Kenojuak Ashevak passed away. She died as she had wished, in her home, peacefully, and in her sleep. And with her went a shining light that had graced the world for 85 long years. It was my privilege and honor to have known Kenojuak for more than half of those years, and like so many of you, to have been touched by her. She was magic. From her first drawings done in the late 1950s to those completed less than a year ago, her joyous works of art have dazzled and delighted us. Her art was so prominent that it was often overshadowed the fact that she was both a pioneer and a visionary. The concept of art making was brand new when she and others began to move into the settlements. No one really knew what an artist was or what an artist did. Kenojuak defined this role for her contemporaries and for generations to come. She did this not just through her passion and her great visual imagination, but quite simply through her dedication and hard work. Perhaps her greatest legacy is the motivation and inspiration that she has provided for an array of dynamic younger artists working today in Cape Dorset. Some of us were very lucky. We were able to know her outside of the art shows and the openings, and to share companionship and laughter. We came to see her beyond the beauty of her art and to understand her warmth, her sense of humor, her humanity, and her infinite love for life and those of us around her. Her funeral in Cape Dorset took place on January 11th in the school auditorium, which was large enough to house the huge crowd that attended. Petsilat Niviaksi, a fellow artist and master printer, was the lay minister who led the songs and the Bible readings. And with many of us in attendance, she was laid to rest in the cemetery on a late, dark, blustery afternoon. The following day was sunny, and a group of us gathered at Jimmy Manning's house for tea. It was the day that had been predicted for the arrival of the sun, that magical day when, for the first time in months, the edge of the sun would peek over the hills, symbolically ending the long, dark winter. One of Kenojuak's most famous images, and one of her personal favorites, celebrates this significant event. This is the print entitled The Arrival of the Sun. And just after noon hour, it happened. We rushed outside and took pictures for the few minutes that the bright tip of sunlight was peeking over the hills. It sank quickly, and we went back inside. And then 10 minutes later, it suddenly came back, cresting over a lower ridge, larger and stronger, and spreading its light so much further. Rising over the hill behind the cemetery, where in the vast field of white snow and white crosses, a small carpet of colored flowers marked Kenojuak's resting place. You see, she herself was enchanted. And it is just possible that this was her way of letting us know that her sparkle had not truly been taken from us. She knew that her spirit would live on in the magnificent body of works she left for us. She knew it would live on in the minds and hearts of her family, her children, her grandchildren, her great-grandchildren, and all of her friends. And also in the hearts of us who knew her, who loved her, who laughed with her, and who rejoiced in her presence. As Jimmy set off fireworks that evening to light her way to the sky, we realized that this really should not be a sad time, but a celebration of the life of a great lady who made our world a brighter place. Thought you'd like that, Terry. Terry Ryan arrived in Cape Dorset in 1960. As a young artist who had graduated from OCAD, he had been determined to paint in the Arctic. He had already lived for 2 years further north on Baffin Island at the weather station in Clyde River before he came to Cape Dorset. Then, he was asked to travel to Cape Dorset to replace Jim Houston and work with the artists in the fledgling art studios. Soon he became general manager of the Cape Dorset Co-op, the first southerner, that is, a non-Inuit person, ever to be hired by an all-Inuit organization. There he stayed for over 40 years, successfully guiding the Cape Dorset Co-op and the King Knight Studios to their current very prominent place in the arts in Canada. Terry was a colleague, a mentor, and a lifelong friend to Kenojuak. And they both had the Order of Canada, I might add. When he arrived in Cape Dorset, she was one of the group of artists who had begun drawing. Even then, it was apparent that she was special. As early as 1963, her work was the subject of a film about making of the print entitled Arrival of the Sun. That was when this photograph was taken of Terry Kenojuak and her beloved husband, Johnny Bow, looking at the finished print. Over their years, Terry and Kenojuak worked together, forging a relationship that was to flourish until the end of her life. When they were together, this special bond was evident as they talked and reminisced and made each other laugh. We are privileged to have Terry here with us today. Okay, well, ignore part of this one. And to Sarah. It's a great shot of Sarah and Kenojuak. Sarah Milroy is known to all of you, an engaging writer, formerly editor of Canadian Art Magazine, art critic, and curator. She is also one of the most insightful, sensitive, and feeling people that I have ever met. Both in the South and on several trips to Cape Dorset, Sarah came to know Kenojuak, and in her special way, Sarah understood the force of this remarkable woman and delighted in it. I can think of no one who could better give us an insight into the art of Kenojuak. Sarah? To you, I pass the
torch.
I pass the torch.
Pat, thank you so much for those remarks. I'm quite taken aback. And it's such an honor to share the stage today with Terry and with Pat, who have such a long, deep attachment, had such a long and deep attachment to Kenojuak. And I owe to Pat the instant access I got deep into the bosom of the Ashevak family when we went to Cape Dorset twice in the last year and a half together. And I never would have had such privileged access without Pat's good housekeeping seal of approval. So It's been one of the great intellectual adventures of my life, finding out more about Inuit art in Canada, and I'm so grateful. And thus, you know, sharing the stage with them, I think it's fair to say I may likely be the least appropriate person to be up here, because there's several people here who have known Kenojuak for decades. And I only met her, as I say, for the first time about a year and a half ago, as she was coming to the conclusion of her long and in every way estimable life. But like many Canadians, I already had a very profound connection to her art and to her through it. I was 3 years old when she made the drawing for The Enchanted Owl in 1960, and I was 13, and this part I remember, when that drawing was turned into a stamp. And I can remember that moment in Canadian history quite vividly, although I was very young. It was 3 years after Expo 67. It was 2 years after the first election of Pierre Trudeau, an event which maybe people in the audience have different feelings about, but which I found thrilling. And there was a general sense, I could even tell in those very early years of my life, of Canada having coming to a different sense of itself. And there had been a sense of strong national identity established in Canada, you know, during the travails of the First and Second World War. Our earlier identity as trappers and coureurs du bois, then the Pearson years, and then Trudeau and Expo. But in my recollection, the publication of that stamp and the release, actually, of that print as well, marked a kind of moment in which our indigeneity as a Canadian people became kind of part of our brand. And I think, I mean, we're in the room here with some works by Norval Morisseau, some works by Daphne Ojig. Kenojuak's work is, we're going to be walking through that in a few moments. But these were these figures in our nation were pioneers in the sense of changing the way in which what it meant to be Canadian, how that came to evolve. And we're still working through the complexities of branding ourselves as Indigenous, even as our Indigenous people struggle to find their rightful place in our society. And we're speaking today about a great Inuit woman artist, and you know, I want to turn our attention for a moment to the report that was released this week to much fanfare about the plight of Aboriginal and Indigenous women and girls across the country. I can only imagine what Kenojuak's example means to Indigenous women in Canada, the fortitude of her vision, her strength of character, and her resilient, unquenchable joy for life, and the way in which her her images remind us of the things that matter, how we're bound to each other, how we're bound to the land, the delight that we are lucky enough to be able to take in the natural world that surrounds us as Canadians, and our loyalty to those things. And I think her work really really reminds us of what counts. And in that, even though she would never have declared herself an activist or a political artist in any way, I think we can see a kind of political force in these images, just in how they assert those values. I see them as deeply value-laden works of art. She's also part of that generation that is now almost extinct, which people that started out life living entirely on the land in traditional ways, and which made the transition into modern, you know, European-influenced ways of living together in towns and cities. And this makes this generation, as they pass from our view, very, very precious in terms of our own country's history. She has experienced everything from being a child on the land and watching so carefully and closely the animals that she later would depict in her art, and the changing of the seasons and the coming of the sun, as Pat has brought us today, all the way through to flying in a jet plane down to Toronto to attend the opening at the Art Gallery of Ontario of Inuit Modern, and coming to see Inuit art reframed in a completely new, much more politicized and feminized way in our own historical moment. So she was witness to such an extraordinary transition there and transformation. So she taught us an awful lot, and she taught us about being Canadian in the ways that I've described. And so I was very excited when I found out I was going to actually be able to go and visit her in her home. I'd met her very, very briefly at the AGO when she was in her wheelchair being pushed by her nephew, Tim Pitsulak, and she was in every way the kind of queen of Inuit art that day. Everyone was feting her, but she wore her royal crown with a kind of folksy charm and was always sort of unfailingly gracious and friendly and, you know, cozy is the word, with everyone that she met, and delighted that people were so interested in what she'd done. She had seen a lot in her life, and I just want to touch briefly on it. She started out living on the land, as I said. She'd lost her father rather traumatically early in life. He had been the son, it is said, of a shaman, and her father was singled out by a pack of people and was killed. And her own knowledge of this was not something she talked about a lot, but it was very a disturbing part of her young life and would have required considerable resilience to pull through that experience. I don't think she ever gave any impression to anyone that it even broke her stride. Her life force was such that she pushed through it. She survived being exiled to a hospital in Quebec City for the treatment of tuberculosis when she was a young mother. She survived the sorrow of losing two of her children who died when she was away in her absence. Yet somehow, when she came back to Cape Dorset, she was able to persevere and to adapt to the new world of art making, which of course, in the sense that it was practiced at Kinngate's studio, was something completely new to the Inuit people. And she adapted to that, and she adapted to life in town and raised a wonderful family. And I'm so glad they're with us today through this marvelous cyber experience we're having. Asked about her artistic motivations, Kenojuak would always defer deep analysis, saying that she just wanted to make beautiful things. And she just wanted to fill the page up with beautiful decorations. And words like decoration, of course, are anathema in the South when it comes to artists. But, you know, I don't think her aesthetic instincts were far more remarkable than she likely knew. And I think she's being honest with us when she tells us what, you know, what she thought she was up to. But what she may not have perhaps understood, given her modesty, was how extraordinary her aesthetic sensibility was, her instincts. And what we can see now that she's no longer with us is that they're capable of holding in them, in a very palpable way, a feeling of her resilient joy and her sense of wonder. And that absolutely it's on record. It's here at the McMichael, it's here in the storage vaults, it's wherever her prints are looked at. It cannot be extinguished, and that is truly the sign of a magnificent artist. So we've all looked at Kenojuak's prints, and so what I wanted to do today, just for about 10 minutes before I sit down to talk with Terry, who knew her far, far, far better than anyone of us here could ever hope to, is to just walk through some of her drawings, which are, I want to give a brief shout out here for the McMichael and Victoria. This is a surprise for you, but these drawings came from the co-op, and they're being stored at the McMichael right now, if I've got this correct. And they are an incredible body of work, her drawings from which the prints were made. I don't know that these have been exhibited. They are wonderful, wonderful drawings. And they are being kept safe here. And that's the kind of work that the McMichael is doing. It's a rather an unheralded act of heroism. But these would not be safe if they were not in a museum. And it costs money to keep things like this safe and apply conservation to them and document them in the way that they have and take care of them and make them available for scholars and so on. So this is just one of the many thankless tasks that McMichael undertakes on behalf of Inuit art and Canadian art in general. So what I have behind me here is the work that everyone knows best that I was speaking about. And I'm going to just take us at a kind of a walking pace through some of the drawings, because there's not tons and tons to say about them, but it's kind of a rare opportunity. There are more than 2,000 here at the McMichael in storage, and I picked, I think, about 80 of my favorites. So here we go. This is another print, another early print, and I know that Terry has one of these prints of this image, but I believe it's printed in the other color scheme hanging in his home here in Toronto. This is another print from the 80s. And here, I just want to make a brief mention of the kind of things that are landmark, this sense of animals and people morphing into each other, an incredible sense of balance and composition, the liveliness and tautness of the line in the image, and a kind of buoyancy and sense of humor that you pick up on when you look at the image. And the prints, you know, the prints, this is a later piece from the 80s, the prints carry this, but what we don't perhaps know as much about is that before Kenojuak made prints, she made these bags, and I just came across these by accident the other day at Pat's. It was the day that I heard that Kenojuak had died, or possibly the day afterwards, and I went down to have a scotch and celebrate with Pat, and she went in the back and dug out this cardboard box, and these bags were in it, and these were things that I suppose she had been working with Alma Houston and the workshop making these wonderful things. But you can see very clearly, this is before she was printmaking, that she had a very distinctive design sensibility, and this is not advancing. This gives us a chance to look at this bag more carefully. It's always nice to have a moment to not go too quickly. I mean, one of the things that's important to look at in this bag, actually, is this characteristic Kenojuak effect of the bulging kind of energy at the end of the line. And it's something that happens, you could see it here too, the way in which the line becomes widened at the end. And it seems to denote a kind of force that is moving out through these, moving out through the forms and kind of collecting at the end as if to enhance the kind of sense of the radiance. Are we good? Yes. So you can see in these depictions, I presume it's of plants, but the central motif could be a plant or merely a sort of a decorative embellishment. But here you can see that these two women, it's interesting that they're dressed really in, I noticed this after we did the piece in the Globe and Mail, Pat, that they're wearing dresses, these women, so it's likely that these were objects made not for personal use or for the family, but for trade, and because they're depicting, scenes of Hamlet life. This is a real stunner. And again, you get that sense that she already has there of the balanced design of those radiant forms that seem to be seething with energy as they get out to their extremities. I love this. So she goes from making the bags to making the prints, and Terry can tell us more about that process when we're talking, but one of the first prints she made, I think maybe it is the first print, was Rabbit Eating Seaweed, and this print actually came directly off of a decorative motif that she had on a bag, and the effort was made to translate that directly into a work on paper. Needless to say, works on paper were not things that were part of traditional Inuit life, paper not being on the cards. So this is a drawing for Bird Fantasy, and so I just wanted to show the distinction between the drawings, which where you can see the touch, and then one of the inevitable aspects of the translation to the print medium is that you lose a sense of the hand, and I just wanted to take us back to her hand, because we can sort of feel a little bit closer to her this way. These are very early. I think that the this whole first section of drawings that I'm going to show you are all from 59 to 66. It's kind of, there's a big bale of them, and it's not really itemized what was done when. So. But they have some interesting features to them, like these wonderful imaginary animals. And I think sometimes in contemporary Inuit art, we see a figure like Shuvanai Ashuna making these sort of imaginary bestiaries, and it seems like a fresh invention. But actually, there's a long tradition there. And Pat was just telling me that there was an exhibition here called Strange Scenes back in the 80s. That incorporated a lot of early work that had these kind of exotic figments. I just want to show these quickly, and I'm just going to walk through them because they are so intimate. And I believe that's a mosquito, if I'm not mistaken, because it shows you that, when you're perhaps representing things at a scale of their importance rather than in any kind of traditional European perspectival modality. Sometimes things that are very small can get very hugely annoying. So I don't know how else to interpret that. But here is what appears to be lice. I love this little drawing because it's like truly making the most of what you have around you as iconography. And those little bastards, you know. Here we have people turning into birds and birds turning into people. Again, it's worth reminding ourselves that Kenojuak came out of a tradition of Inuit figuration and mask making and so on that was much beloved of the European surrealists, and André Breton and Man Ray and others were avid collectors of Inuit art, and we can see that she's, you know, working out of a tradition that ends up being very influential in European art as well. The family unit. And of course, you know, it goes without saying that there's a flat decorative treatment of the space rather than a traditional perspectival straight space. And in that sense, they're, you know, they're sort of proto-modern without going through traditional representation first. I'm interested in how this motif at the top really reminds us of the bags in the sense of filling up the space and providing just sheer pleasure. I'm presuming this is Sedna we see on the bottom, who is the mythical figure under the sea who makes good things happen, but who I also think of as the goddess of keeping on, because she gets thrown out of the boat and by her father, and when she tries to get back in, he chops off all her fingers, and they go down and become seals and walruses and so on. I always think of her as kind of a symbol of female resilience. And I just think these many of these drawings have not been made into prints. I love the sense of, so I think that's why it's really interesting to look at them, the sense of everything being connected to everything else. This is one of the things about indigenous cultures that is often, it shows up in many different ways in different things made by people in the Arctic and in other parts of Canada, but the sense of interconnectedness is something worth thinking about. You see imaged in this early drawing, family life on the land. This fabulous owl strutting its stuff. It's real, I suppose it's been surprised and it's trying to defend its territory. A lot of morphology of things taking on different faces and transforming between modes. We're getting revved up for the enchanted owl here. But we've it's just a wonderful richness of diversity, and I love the sense of affection also for the natural world that you see in her drawings, the seal and walrus that are so sweet-faced. Just take a moment here and just walk through with her. This is a wonderful creature. It's part caribou, part owl. This is a party. I mean, I don't know where we go with this. It's fantastic. This creature at the top in the middle is, you know, Shuv and I would like that one. I must thank Victoria, too, because she saved the day. When we put these up half an hour ago, they were so bleached that we really couldn't see them. And through her cyber wizardry, she's restored them to legibility. And so we can have a look at them. How much do we love this? I think one of the things about Kenojuak's owls that I notice is that the owls are actually, this is quite the player here. The owls are actually a lot more characterful than the people. And I don't know if that reflects Kenojuak's interest in human beings as opposed to owls, but she puts so much personality into the owls, and that was one of her favorite motifs, of course, and she often said, you know, I am the owl, or I am a happy owl. And indeed, she looked like a happy owl. She was short, but powerful. She was small, but, you know, packed a punch. She was had an incredible eye, a kind of a piercing insight and ability to look at things and you know, spot things. But I decided that her identification with the owl was such that we needed to get behind the scenes here and look at a few of her owls that didn't make it to print, or at least I don't think they did. That one may have. That one did. The tiptoeing owl, I call this one. They have such psychological presence. I call this the vampire owl. This is a wild and crazy one. So this is more, gives you a sense of her playfulness and how she, you know, how much fun she had making up images. And she would start something and sort of work with it, whatever happened. And some of these experiments, you know, produce kind of unusual results. But you can see, you know, her sense of experimentation with the fish mouth. That's a beautiful image. Harlequin owl. Bad hair day owl, I call this. I mean, what happened there? You know, I love it. And this is, I call the George Clooney owl. He's got those bedroom eyes, you know. Such a dapper fellow. And then this glorious one, which is, to me, just so feminine and so delicate and full of personality. So those are her owls, and her owls are her. So what I'm going to do now is thank you so much for your attention. And I'm going to go back up on the stage and have a few words with Terry Ryan, who was so lucky to spend so many years with Kenojuak, working with her, and drawing the very best from her. So here I go, try not to fall down the stairs. There you go. So the question is, is my mic working? Yeah. So I wanted to ask you, Terry, and I'm going to ask you to hold your mic super close to your mouth when you're talking, but can you talk to me about meeting her the first time? I should say, too, that we have not rehearsed. He has only the vaguest sense of what I'm going to say, because I'm a big believer in spontaneity, but...
Me?
Yes. But can you tell me about meeting her the first time, or had you heard about her before you met her? How was that first encounter?
Well, I think I met Kenojuak first in 1958, where I was returning from North Baffin. Clyde River, and we sailed into Cape Dorset, because that particular year the south wind had kept all the ice on shore, so they had to go on by and do the high Arctic. Then they came back in the fall and did the survey. So she was aboard the ship with Johnny Boner, many relatives, and I was introduced to her by Jim Houston, I guess. But I didn't really know much about her. She wasn't yet an icon in the north, in the south.
She'd been making work for some time, though, already.
She'd been doing very small little scratches, really. It's rather amazing to look through her work and see her development. And all that is here at the McMichael. But the she always had a smile on her face. She was very, particularly during the years that she was married to Johnny Bo.
Yeah.
Johnny Bo unfortunately died of appendicitis, simply because the plane could not get in from Frobisher Bay in those days.
Yeah.
And they didn't have the serum, whatever it was. And she missed him greatly. But then he was always smiling as well. He's a real smiler. But her personality was there all the time. But back in Dorset, or when I returned to Dorset in 1960, she was one of the few people whose work was being assessed, as it were. That's a terrible word.
Yes.
It was being looked at by the printmakers.
Yes.
And myself. Jim left in the fall of 61 and came back briefly in 62 to pack up and go, but mm-hmm. he had obviously focused on her as well. Mm-hmm. And you could see her style developing.
And was part of the decision, like you obviously, the co-op made a big investment in making her prints. I guess one of the reasons that it would have been a natural to translate to the print medium was because of how firm the line was and how bold her sort of designs were. They had a certain kind of ferocious vitality about them.
Yeah, her work was kind of obvious in a pile of her drawings mm-hmm. of that kind of approach to drawing. Other people were more, I shouldn't say more decorative, because she's very decorative. Dorset has never been very narrative in its work. It was work I collected years later in North Bath and showed a lot of people want to tell you stories, illustrating yes. those stories. It happened in Dorset, but she chose early on to mm-hmm. create motifs and just went on developing them.
So her emphasis was less on storytelling and more on the one iconic moment or the one iconic image or...
Not always.
Or making a design. But yeah, you're right. There isn't really a sense of narrative.
No.
Occasionally she'll make those scenes where people, like the family is scattered around and the tents are there, but it's not as if something is happening. It's more that the figures are in the space.
She also was aware of her, I think, of the reception that her work got.
Mm-hmm.
And she was commissioned several times. She went up to Japan with Johnny Bo, to Osaka, I think, and other commissions. And mm-hmm. she really enjoyed meeting other artists and playing with,
oh, yeah.
with her own work.
And how involved was she in talking to the people that were making the prints about, do we do this or do we do that? Was she interested in the printmaking process, or was she really more focused on the drawings?
No, she was primarily a drawer. Mm-hmm. Not many of the people got involved with the printmaking,
right.
other than the staff.
Yes.
They just didn't understand the process.
Right.
You know, occasionally have somebody come into the studio and you point to something that's on the wall that's being proofed. They say, that's wonderful, who did it? And
yeah.
Putlu was another one of those people.
Mm-hmm.
And occasionally she would be reprimanded by some of the printmakers. I remember Iola came to her one day during those early 60s when we were doing a lot of engravings.
Mm-hmm.
And he got tired of wiping the plate on and on and on. So unbeknownst to me, he told her to stop making these things.
To stop?
Stop making them. That we had enough of those. I didn't know until months later when I asked her, why have you stopped? You gone back to paper, why don't you continue on with your engravings?
Yeah.
She said, Iola told me not to.
Yeah, sad enough.
But she was a pretty strong lady, so she moved on her own.
Yeah.
But her work certainly evolved, and you see a lot of work that looks like her Enchanted Owl, but that came afterwards.
Yeah.
All the original drawing, the Enchanted Owl, which is in the National Gallery, is a very finished work.
Mm-hmm.
And the her way of drawing, the early drawings, awful echo here, she would start in the upper, off in the upper left-hand corner of the paper, and she just seemed to have in her mind's eye what was going to happen down here.
Yeah. She'd just start.
She'd just start. Mm-hmm. She wouldn't have the idea there was four birds or five birds, six birds. They would evolve as she started to draw. I sat watching her one night out in her camp. We were on our way down to sail down to our stone site, which is about 150 miles from here, Dorset, to put together the soapstone to bring back for the community or steatite. And I stayed in her igloo, as people call them. Not the Inuit people, but we people. And she had a baby on her back who was very ill. And we had just arrived, and it was dark and stormy, and I wanted to take her back to the nursing station in Dorset, but she said no, that there was no need.
Mm-hmm.
So Most of them went to sleep on the platform. You all sleep in the one platform.
Yes.
But by the light of the kulik, she, as they all do, they sit with their legs out and a board on it, paper on the board. Mm-hmm. It's about the only time of day the women could find time to do it.
Yeah.
The kids were a distraction. Chores left for their husband had to be attended to. Mm-hmm. But in the evening when the husband was sleeping, she'd draw. So I watched her finish this drawing. I was just amazed. It's one thing to stop me from doing my own work because
I can't do this.
Well, so many of the people, the old women in particular, Pitchlack Ashun and Lucy, and you'd strive as a graduate of the College of Art to work on landscape, and you had a frustrating weekend trying to paint. And the Monday morning in walked three or four or five little old ladies and pulled these rolls
straight out of their mind on the paper.
And they said, there's all sparkle on the table.
What's so interesting is that the process, it's like she's working through, there's no decision necessarily. I mean, you're saying that she sees it all in her mind's eye, but I'm wondering if also at times if she wasn't discovering it in the making of it as it happens, so it's this totally organic process that ends up in this kind of intuitively arrived at final product, but it's not like churning something out. You know, it's like an act of discovery on the page, and that's what you really feel when you look at those drawings is the one thing morphing into another and a kind of sense of an organic process. And it's quite extraordinary to start at one corner of a page and be able to work all the way through to the boom. Put a period on the end of it.
Well, the end of that story was working in her on the sleeping platform that evening. I fell asleep, and then the next morning we were up because we were moving on with the boats. And I wasn't aware that the child had died during the evening, but she didn't know, and I'm sure that's why she had said there was no need to go back to Cape Dorset. The evening before, because she knew her child was dying. But she was very together, very strong woman.
And very industrious, too.
Yeah. And didn't take any guff from anybody, including me.
Was she seen in the community as a leader figure, apart from her artwork? Was she a person that people sought advice from, or?
I think
looked direction?
As she got older, she did, but she wasn't. No, there were other older women than her who had that role to play. Mm-hmm. But I never sensed that she was, as she got more notoriety, I guess she had to sort of watch it in the sense that she'd return home with also the gifts. And like winning the lotto, your neighbors aren't particularly happy with you. Happy for you, maybe.
Yeah.
But she was very strong. If she disagreed with you on something, she'd let you know about it.
And can you tell me about a time when you came to antler to antler with her on something?
Oh, there's many times.
And who tended to win? And how did that work out?
Well, when she would look at something, and she did a couple of large murals. And she started off by saying, I'm not going to paint all this. I said, well, you can get somebody to help you after you lay out your design. She was commissioned to do work for the CNR.
Oh, yeah.
In their club cars.
Mm-hmm.
It was all aluminum. So we did one, we did two, and they were very successful. But then when she was asked to do yet another one for their head office, she said, no, I don't want to do that. I said, well, good money in for you. Well, then she'd think about that. Mm-hmm. Well, what's good money? And of course, she had all her, as all the Inuit women do, they had a lot of pressure on them from family, eh?
Right.
to the point where on occasion she would send a drawing in that signed by her, but wasn't hers.
Ooh.
It was by Johnny Bo, but she loved Johnny Bo so much that she would give him credit for the work.
I see.
But she, I think it was Chancellor Schmidt who came in the Dorset one day some years ago, and in the morning we gave him a tour of our studios, and she, of course, was brought down, bringing her favorite personage that we pushed out in front of everybody.
Mm-hmm.
And he was saying, he commented to me that she was a very contained lady. Yeah, she was very, very secure.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And he wanted to make other remarks, but she was looking at him thinking, who is this guy? But she always expected some little token of appreciation for what she'd given her presence. And of course, people of his ilk always brought something with them. I mean, he gave her a very lovely little butane lighter or something made in Germany. Because she loved to smoke.
Mm-hmm.
Now she was, I always remember as a happy person. Mm-hmm. Whenever she'd see her, unless something had happened.
Was she a person who liked, did she tease? Was she a...
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Did she ever pull a joke on you?
She tried to.
Yeah? Can you tell us about that? What did she have in store for you?
She annoyed me on one occasion because she thought we were both the same age.
You were the same age?
Well, she told me I was.
She told you, okay.
And I've never corrected her. Mm-hmm. And she came to me one day and said that you've been misleading me.
You're
misleading her.
Oh, yes.
Because I never commented on it. I said, what's important about it? Well, to put me in a different light. So she was...
Oh, but you showed you more respect.
Yeah.
Almost a wise elder.
Yeah. No, she suffered through two more husbands after Johnny Bo died.
Right.
I shouldn't say that. But she was never as happy as she was sort of bringing his memories to life.
Mm-hmm.
But as an individual, and one, she's very prolific.
Mm-hmm.
Two, she was, I wouldn't say demanding, but she was attentive to the fact that if she came in the room with her work, mm-hmm. you didn't go through the door.
Mm-hmm.
Or she'd send somebody after you. You need to have all sorts of excuses for having to leave the building. So she wanted her due, eh? Which was
she had a lot of confidence that she had talent.
She had a lot of confidence, yeah. She undertook all sorts of commissions which aren't evident. As you say, there are so many of her drawings in this collection here that's phenomenal.
And do you, after all these years, have a favorite work of hers? Do you have a work of hers that seems like most to carry her essence in your mind?
Yes, but I don't think they won't necessarily print, so I can't really.
Mm-hmm. Can you describe it to us?
It's one of her connected works, in the sense that she had in mind what she was out to achieve. Mm-hmm. And regardless of what sort of barrier she met on the way,
mm-hmm.
she just moved through it.
Yeah.
Wouldn't comment, didn't ask for any input from you,
mm-hmm.
just carried on and
mm-hmm.
smoked and grew.
Cracked a few jokes.
Yeah.
What do you make of her identification with the owl?
It's her.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, it's very much her. And their faces are her in a lot of the other drawings where you just see a face
mm-hmm.
among the others. That's very much her face, mm-hmm. which is not unheard of among a lot of artists. But I don't know, there's so many memories of her that I,
mm-hmm.
memories of her reprimanding me for something or other.
Oh, yeah. I'm getting to get a picture of this relationship. It's
yeah. Or if you told her that what we used to do, on occasion was at the end of the production year, in the attempt to maintain your budgets, not that we had any budgets, but in order to hold your cash, as it were, we'd sell them out of paper. Oh, they never would be out of paper for Kenojuak. Or what she'd do was she'd go get some terrible paper and do a drawing on it, knowing that I just couldn't stand that.
Yeah.
I'd find some paper for her. But she was, she always had something to say to you.
Yeah.
And generally was something to do. A bit of sarcasm or a mm-hmm. bit of a dig.
Mm-hmm. Was she interested in, one of the things that's interesting about the body of work is there's not a lot of depiction of traditional myths and legends and so on. Did she, it's particularly interesting to me given the fact that her grandfather had this rather remarkable reputation as possibly having been a shaman and that there's that mystical, you know, lineage in that family of supernatural sort of sensitivity. Did she talk about her feelings about traditional shamanic beliefs at all, or was that just...
No.
No.
Well, she may have, but not to me.
Not to you, yeah.
One, my nuctitude was never perfect. And
but at that time, too, I suppose in the North, those kinds of practices were largely kind of happening underground and not necessarily in view of white visitors. That certainly was the case in Igloolik during that period, that it was those shamanic practices and healing and so on were still going on into the 70s, but they were not, it was all not even referred to.
Well, it wasn't.
With outsiders.
The church had come.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of those expressions, which you saw in some of the early drawings, mm-hmm. or a lot of the early drawings, not so much by Kenojuak, but Ishivadlo and mm-hmm. Sharni and other people depicted images that were really in their head. In a way other than you see today with Annie Puduk or mm-hmm. Shurina, mm-hmm. who have some describable problem.
Mm-hmm.
But no, she never did. She was never very narrative. She had a couple of commissions from mm-hmm. from the church to depict a passage in the Bible, but she didn't really like that.
Yeah.
She didn't like drawing figures in a great degree unless they enhanced the owl.
Stick with owls.
Yeah.
I imagine there's some people, well, first of all, Pat, do you have some thoughts about questions that are coming to your mind here, or should we open it to the floor? Or?
I think we should, I want to hear more stories from Terry, but I'm not sure.
Yeah, me too, me too, but.
I think we should open it to the floor.
Yeah, all right. Does anyone have anything they want to ask? The great silence fell. I think that Pat and I were looking at this the other day, and we figured two had died when she was in the South.
And another one died.
Another one died before.
You were in the camp. I think there were, in the process, both adopted and natural children. I think there were a total of 11.
Yeah.
I think so.
Seven of whom made it. Yeah. Through to adult life.
Yeah. Could you repeat the questions, please? Because we
can back. Well, the question was, how many children did she have? And
The whole approach to adoption in the North is really very casual. The child who died, her child, the next woman in town, the next woman in Cape Dorset, who had a baby. Kenojuak took mm-hmm. to be raised by her, and that was Arnasu.
Mm-hmm.
But then her next baby was given back to that mother, the other mother, Petrolasi.
So the idea of the nuclear family with a wall around it is mm-hmm. more of our kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
But the, it always rather amazed me, really, in my early years in the North, that you'd see a family walking through town who the husband wasn't that great a hunter or had his limitations, and consequently the children were not comfortably dressed on occasion. But you'd say to the brother of that child, the blood brother, that's your brother down there, aren't you be concerned about it? Can't you load him a pair of boots or something? But no, that wasn't, it was cut off. although people did return back to the community a bit away and were accepted back into the community in the sense that their brothers would recognize them.
Well, it's part of a whole notion of, you know, sharing wealth. Mm-hmm. I mean, I remember being in Igloolik back in 1991, and there was a whale, and all the men ran down and got in the boats and went out, and they killed it. It was a beluga. They brought it back. They butchered it. And in every house in town, within an hour and a half, it seemed, there was a, you know, an aluminum roasting, you know, like a tinfoil roasting pan with a slab of whale meat in it on the floor in their house or on the front step, you know, inside the front door. And it was just instantly shared with the whole community. Now, this is quite a while ago. I mean, it's going back. It's
still very much the case.
But it's still very much the case, I understand.
When yeah. Tim comes back. Mm-hmm. From a hunt, which is, he's almost always successful,
yeah.
then it is all shared with the community.
So. Yeah. Which is pretty remarkable in mm-hmm. this day and age.
Well, it's interesting, mm-hmm. just to touch on that, when our government brought people into the community, or encouraged people to come to the community, because there's, in our wisdom, we felt that was the thing to do, that there was some reluctance on part of some people to come in. They didn't want to change their lifestyle. Mm-hmm. Others would come in, and you could see that distribution of food move through town as the more houses were built. Mm-hmm. And although you came from one camp, say Kavashak, other people, your neighbor didn't come from your camp. You knew them, but you didn't know them well. Mm-hmm. But if someone from your original camp came into Dorset, you're now living in Dorset, you'd see that boat go here, then over here, and then over here to deliver to past members of your camp.
Yeah, right? Yeah. Those old attachments, yeah. Family attachments, remained intact.
And they still remain. They still mm-hmm. live. Mm-hmm. But
yes, another question in the front.
Clearly, she by the end of her days, she was much of a star.
Mm-hmm. These two would be much more in a position to answer that question than I, but. Oh, sorry, the question is, to what extent was she a mentor to other Aboriginal women in that community? Yeah, as an artist.
She was towards the end, mm-hmm. and that's the last 5 or 10 years. But not initially. There was a lot of competition between her and several other women who felt that they should have had a trip down south. But what am I trying to say? She, I don't know if that really interested her in those early days. She was very much trying to build her own style of drawing. And no one paid any particular attention to her. And you weren't aware of the prominence of that person here in the South and in the market because you didn't live there. As I often said to some of our dealers, especially our distant dealers, one of which was very successful in Mannheim, Germany, he'd bring people over, but it enhanced his reputation as the gallery owner, but didn't do much for the artist in question because they were totally unknown, although the acceptance of the art form internationally had grown considerably. I remember two such instances was that if you had brought the exhibit back to Cape Dorset, or brought or left it, you had your exhibit in Dorset, preferably maybe 10 miles away or 15 miles away in a place where people usually gather in the summertime, and you put that up and people got a lot of attention, then your reputation would grow. But sort of out of sight, out of mind was often the case with the carving and the drawing. You brought something in, nobody got to see it, and it was gone. So it took years for that to be worthwhile. But then when her reputation grew, and her neighbor after 10 years said, oh, you're dry, there was more Mm-hmm. And there's really, given the time that's passed, there's a whole generation of young people who are kind of lost in this. So it's the grandchildren now mm-hmm. who have started to show some real interest in her work. But often people have worked in real solitude.
Yeah, real isolation.
Especially women who live on the land until the latter years. They really had nobody to talk to about their work, which I much regret in the sense that people would come in and tell me what they were doing, but it went in one ear and out the other. Or I retained a bit of it. But mm-hmm. I know that old Parr, not to digress from, he'd bring in work and he'd go on and on about these strange drawings he was doing. And although I understood a great part of it, I regret today that we didn't have a recorder or something to take all the remarks down. And all the curators are all trying to figure out what they're trying to say.
Yeah.
I think one of the things about Kenojuak as a mentor to other artists is that one of the things that's happening now that's so exciting in this community is that artists from the South are traveling up there. They're looking at this sort of wellspring of imagery and the work that was made in this kind of classic period and wanting to go up and work with artists in that community now. So I'm just thinking of artists from Toronto like Sherry Boyle or Ed Pian who have been going up and spending time in Kingate Studio, you know, getting to know the artists there and collaborating. I think Sherry and Shuvanai have made some work together and so on. So I think this tradition is starting to really draw the attention of artists in the rest of Canada to look at it and find inspiration there and find new sources for strength for their own vision. And that's kind of a new development of the last, you know, four or five years, an interest in that. And it's very exciting because the work is pretty wonderful that comes out of it too. Yeah.
Well, it's interesting in the, we've had about 50 visiting artists over the years. Mm-hmm. And it's always intrigued me that the work has affected the visiting artist more than he's left any imprint, he or she, on their visits to the community, because it didn't seem to affect the Inuit approach to their expression.
No, it affects the Southerners who come. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah.
I remember Michael Snow's wife. Michael Snow's wife.
Oh, Peggy Gale or Joyce Wheeland.
Joyce came up, and she brought with her. And Joyce was a pretty outgoing person.
Yeah.
So she had arranged one evening to show some films. Well, in those days, films were pretty rare. We'd have a few brought in and we'd show them the community hall.
She was showing her own experimental films.
Well, that's what she planned to do. That's what she did.
Yeah.
But the audience wasn't prepared for this.
So, how did it go over?
Well, they were just all stunned.
Yeah.
She had her little boat sinking and other things. Mm-hmm. So it was over. She thanked them for all coming. They all nodded at her and they all wanted out. So she said, well, what do they think of it? I said, well, that's not a Western.
Yeah. You know?
So you didn't get much reception here.
How did Kenojuak and Joyce Wheeland get on? I'd like to have been a fly on the wall for that meeting.
Which?
Joyce Wheeland and Kenojuak.
Oh, but they got on well.
Yeah?
Yeah.
They spent some time together.
Yeah. But of course, there's all those other artists who were.
Yes. Yeah.
But she was, and she wasn't, she was up to competing too.
Oh, yes?
Yeah. She was, in recent years, we've set up the studios to allow people to come in. Because even though we now have a whole community of 1,500 people, mm-hmm. there's still no place to work at home. Nobody has a studio,
right?
Which is one of the real missing mm-hmm. components. If you don't have it, you can't really do an awful lot of work. So they come into the studios, but if you had Kenojuak and I won't mention names,
yeah,
working together,
people working right beside each other, so they can kind of
yeah. But she would sort of speed up and.
Yeah.
Finish something.
Should accelerate. Yeah. It's lovely. Do we have any other questions here? Yes. Oh.
Sorry, I don't want to ask a question. I want to tell a funny story.
Oh, please.
Which I think Terry may remember.
Can everyone hear?
No, you can use Terry's mic.
You can use Terry's mic for a minute.
Thank you. I don't know whether Terry will remember this event, but as a very new volunteer organization way back in the middle of the 80s, we of this small group entertained Kenojuak and two throat singers following an event here at the McMichael. And Rebecca needs to help with the date, but the date is not important. The fun part of the story is as we were rather stumbling a little bit with entertaining this lovely lady who was visiting us with all her wonderful artwork, and that owl, of course, became our favorite that very day and has never changed. All of a sudden, Kenojuak came to us and said she would like to go to Toronto tomorrow. And as we had no jurisdiction over her activities or where she was to go next, we sort of stumbled, and I think we went to Terry and said, is this a possibility? Anyway, somehow or other, we were granted permission to take her to the city the next day. And then we had to quickly cobble together a group of us who could go, because there were going to be the three people that wanted to go to the city. And we got it all organized, and before we left the site of the supper party, it was all planned, where we would meet and at what time we would meet the following day. And we went to bed praying that there would not be a snowstorm, because we were not feeling that brave about taking these precious people all the way into the city. The long and the short of it was, when we met the next morning, gathered up our guests, the only spot they wanted to go, or at least that Kenojuak wanted to go, was to Wanastead's. And I have to cheerfully tell you that I am a Torontonian. I have lived in Toronto the majority of my life. I did not have a clue where Honest Ed's shop was. Quickly had to find that out as we were driving into the city. And then the really scary part happened. We got parked, we got ourselves all organized. I think we were probably about eight, three guests and five volunteers. And when we got to the front door and went into the shop, as I recall, it was a very busy day. A lot of shoppers were there, and within 3 seconds, we had lost Kenojuak and the throat singers. We all looked at each other in abject panic. So we thought we better have a plan. So we decided that volunteer A would go in that corner and B and C. So we spread out, and we found Kenojuak in the very bottom back corner. The only thing that she really wanted to purchase, which she had not told us, were felt pens. Yeah. They were a brand new something which she had seen, but she had no access. So she spent all of her money and the money that we had on felt pens, and then she said, now we shall leave. So I just thought that was my personal story of Kenojuak.
Wonderful. Victoria, I don't know how you feel, but that seems like a pretty perfect place to stop. But I think she wanted an hour, so yeah, I think that's, she was giving me the signal.
Well, this has been a wonderful afternoon, and I want to thank you all for coming to join us, but let's thank our speakers. It's been wonderful. Okay.
Thank you, Terry.
I hope that those in Cape Dorset were able to hear, and I know sometimes they couldn't see, but I hope they could hear all these wonderful stories. I want to thank everyone who came on behalf of the Board of Trustees and Foundation Directors of the McMichael and Nakomik. Please visit, before you leave, the three exhibitions that are on display now that make up Exploring Cape Dorset Art. They are Kyugik Ashunu, Stories and Imaginings from Cape Dorset, curated by Darlene White at the Winnipeg Art Gallery. Whale's Tales and Other Tales, Cape Dorset's Pudlet Family, curated by Sue Gustavison from the West Baffin Eskimo Co-op Archives, that Sarah spoke about that are on loan to the McMichael. And I think here you see these wonderful drawings that are part of that archive on display. And finally, where do we come from? What are we? Where are we going? Curated by the McMichael curator, Sharona Adamovich Clements. And I want to thank Pat for her help with that exhibition as well. I'd also like to give a special thanks to Jamie Cameron, a trustee of the McMichael, who has been championing Inuit art here at the McMichael for many years and has encouraged our work in this area. Finally, we've prepared a small photographic tribute to Kenojuak's legacy and her presence drawn from the McMichael archives, thanks to Linda Morita, and it's just in the gallery behind us. So thank you to all as well who made this afternoon possible. We've had a lot of hands on deck, and I won't name them all, but you know who you are, and thank you for being here and making this sharing of Kenojuak's life possible. So please enjoy the rest of the afternoon, and once again, thank you for coming and enjoying the story of Kenojuak and her remarkable life.